Kenny Atkinson, the head coach of the Brooklyn Nets, is with us in studio here at the stadium. This is pretty luxurious, huh?
Don, thanks for giving up your seat. I appreciate it. And great intro song. I don't know who chose that.
Yeah, that was RJ. That was nice.
And I love RJ. Michael didn't honor. I've got a rule, Coach, that I do not speak until they say Brooklyn. I think you have to honor the song. You have to honor the city.
Wow.
So
I love it.
That was a bad job out of Michael. Respect. But if I was in the trailer, I'd be sitting on your lap. So I think it's better off that.
Yeah, there's not much room for guests in here. Kenny, this is an interesting year coming up for the Nets. I personally think that you and Sean have done an unbelievable job. I mean, you're facing a lot of obstacles with, you know, none of your own first-round draft picks because of a deal that was made before you were there. They improved so much. You guys improved so much this year. What's next? Is it a quantum leap next?
I mean, that's the dream, right? The quantum leap. I think that's the big goal in the sky. But I also think we've been making solid steps and solid improvements. So, I'd be happy with that too. But we understand what you're saying about the quantum leap. I think our players, you know, see that it's a possibility. But listen, I do think we have to come to it in a humble way too. You know, we only won 28 games last year, 8-game improvement, which was which is good. Mm-hmm. Hard in the NBA, as you know, Michael. Listen, I'd take another 8 to 10 game improvement. That would be fantastic.
Be cool.
Now, can you afford to be a little bit more patient being in Brooklyn than, say, if you were back in New York at the Garden, the Knicks, and how high profile with the media attention? Are you afforded a little bit more patience being with the Nets?
That's a good question. We don't look at it that way internally. Mm-hmm. I know from a media standpoint, you know, you could argue you have a fair point there, but I don't look. I look like we have just as much pressure as they do. We're in the same town. We're in New York. As you know, Brooklyn's a huge basketball borough. So we feel the same pressure, same expectations. And listen, we know we're competing with them. They're in the same town as us, and we welcome that, and look forward to doing better against them than we did last year. We struggled against them last year.
What I like that you guys have done, I'm not a fan of tanking. I don't think you guys have tanked. I mean, you're in a process of, like, turning things over, but it's not tanking. You're trying to win all the time. The Sixers, they tried to lose, and you know what? It worked out for them. They've got a pretty good team. Have you talked to Brett Brown at all about going through something like this?
No, because we've never talked about tanking. Right. Sean and I, I'm just going to be honest, internally, we don't use the word. We don't talk about it. We talk about internal improvement. We talk about player development. We talk about culture, but tanking's not a word we use, Michael. It's just not in our – I don't think the fans of New York want to see that.
And the weird thing, if you're going to tank, this upcoming season would be the year of tank because you finally have your own draft pick. So that's never entered the organization's mind. We get a stud player if we get the first or second pick.
Listen, I think at the probably upper management, I'm sure it's been discussed, but from the coaching, in the coaching room, we don't talk that, and Sean and I don't talk about it. So which is great for me. I can be singularly focused on, right. Hey man, we're trying to get this thing better. We're trying to improve. We're trying to, get us another 4, 6, 8, 10-game improvement, and keep moving upwards.
You played all over Europe. You coached in Europe. Do you have an advantage with European players in the NBA? Did that give you a little bit of expertise to understand them better?
Yeah, good point. I think it's a big reason why I'm in the NBA. I think I came from a, played in the States and in college and all that, but my overseas experience, it just gave me a different perspective, Don. I had Greek coaches, I had Serbian coaches, I had French coaches, Spanish coaches, and I learned a ton over there. And luckily, I was over there at a time when the NBA was really shifting to a more international style of play. There are more international guys in the league, I relate to. I have a good bond with those guys because I have shared common experiences with them.
Do you have to be a different coach now than you could have been 20 years ago? Because I see it in baseball. Everybody goes, well, Billy Martin wouldn't have done that. Billy Martin, I don't think he'd get a job now. That's not the way the sport is, and that's not the way athletes are. So could you coach the same way 20 years ago as you coach now? Or vice versa.
Yeah, I'd like to think if you're a good coach, it doesn't matter. You know, if you're a great coach, it shouldn't really matter. And but I will say the game has changed a ton. The style of play has changed. And I think, you know, the way that the daily life in the NBA as a coach has changed, it's a much more collaborative situation, I think. I wasn't back there 20 years ago, but I do think it's a different style of our culture is different than what the Nets were 20 years ago. It's just a different way of dealing with it.
And this coming season, or after this year, you're going to have a lot of money to spend. And I'm one guy who follows the NBA. I don't understand why teams just completely clear cap space, because it's just a dream. It's air until you spend it. But do you guys dream big and know who's coming out and we're going to try to get these guys, we're going to nail these guys?
Yeah, I think you have to dream big, Michael. You have to dream big. I think it's a little bit on us, you know, how we play this year. The word around the league, because players, they talk to each other. You know, what's it like in Brooklyn? You know, how do they treat you? How do they treat your families? What are the fans like? What's the Barclays Center like? So I think we have all those things in our favor, and I think players talk, I think guys will seriously consider us.
And the Barclays Center is beautiful. It's a great facility, and your training facility is top of the line, awesome. And you're known as a guy who's not a player's coach, which would make you sound easy, but you work with players great. Those would seem to be checklist things for a free agent.
Yeah, I hope so. And we're in a great city of New York. You know, there's nothing like that. And Brooklyn's a special place. You know, I live in Brooklyn. Our whole staff lives in Brooklyn. All our players live in Brooklyn. I feel like there's something special going on. Mm-hmm. I just think through word of mouth and players talking to each other, and agents are a big part of it, obviously. The success we've had with guys like Joe Harris and, you know, guys that, you know, were out of Spencer Dinwiddie's, guys who were out of the league. And, you know, their agents say, hey, you come to Brooklyn, get some opportunity. The coaches will let you play a little bit. Again, I think we have a lot of positive things going in our direction.
I'm going to put you on the spot. Which one? Kenny Atkinson, the Nets coach. Everybody tells me he's such a great coach to teach. He makes people better. How do you do that? How do you make people better? Because that's something that a coach, I guess, would love to have hang on his shingle, but you get to do it because everybody says it, and it's proven because, as you said, a Spencer Dinwiddie becomes a really good player under you.
Yeah, I think, Mike, I think it's probably just like your business, how you've become so good. You get trust, you know. It's to get the players' trust. And then establish, you know, what their weaknesses are and just kind of pound away on that, but also understand their strengths, too. And listen, you know, I always say the best thing about development, you need an opportunity to play. So we've afforded those guys opportunity to play. But I really think it's a trust thing. It's a relationship thing. And once you get that going, then you can take off with a player.
Kenny, is it harder to teach and communicate as a head coach as opposed to an assistant?
Yes. it's such a different world. I can't tell you, and it's been an enormous learning experience, an enormous challenge. They always talk about one seat over. It's all true. It's managing a huge staff. As you know, the staffs have gotten bigger in the NBA, and then managing 15 guys, some guys that aren't playing, guys that are playing. It's a heck of a challenge.
How good could D'Angelo Russell be? Could he be the guy you can build these things around?
Yeah, he's a talented guy, Michael. He's got great court vision. He's got incredible hand-eye coordination. Really understands the game.
He
wants to be great. I think he's been in our gym all summer, like all summer. In the NBA, it's not an obligation. You have to want to be there. So he's been there. He's been really working on his body. He's got to make some strides there. He's got to get stronger. Work on his explosiveness a little bit, but he's proven it to me, you know, by being there every day in the off season.
I have these names. I wrote them down so I didn't forget. Jared Dudley, Ed Davis, Shabazz Napier, and Kenneth Faried. Those guys could really help you.
Yeah.
I'm nice pickups.
Yeah. Remember Kenneth had those, you know, some really good years in Denver. Mm-hmm. Shabazz, I think, had a great year in Portland. You know, I know when we played him, he was on our scouting report, he was their X factor. Like, don't let Shabazz, you know, get off. You know, don't let him shoot that three-point shot. And you know, it's kind of cool. He's a, you know, played locally, played at UConn. So that's great. Ed Davis, solid rebounder, gives us some toughness, Michael, that we need, some real toughness.
You and Alan Hahn went to the same high school. Who's a bigger name?
Oh, Alan. There's no doubt about it.
Oh, he's going to play that on his show.
Oh, my
God.
Yeah,
no, Alan's a bigger name. And maybe one of the all-time nicest guys, right? Yeah.
Did you guys get along? Did you? Because you didn't cross in high school.
No, he was younger than, you know.
Not that much.
Not that much younger than me, but he was definitely, you know, better-looking guy, and that's why he's...
He'll tell you that.
Yeah, he'll tell you that. He's a hockey guy, too, so I know that. And but he's a wonderful guy, and we talk about St. Anthony's, you know, our high school out on Long Island all the time.
So does the losing get to you? I mean, I know you understand the situation you took over, but you're a coach. You want to win. All these years of the losses, does it get to you? Does it wear you down?
Yeah. It gets to you. I think you're a competitor, and there are moments where really, really, and you know what bothers me sometimes, the compliments you get after, oh, they play so hard, or I want to get past that point where it's a little bit more of that, where we're starting to, you know, topple some teams that some good teams in the league. We started to do that. We just got to keep building on it.
Who's the best coach in the NBA? Take yourself out of it.
Oh, best Pop. You got to give it to Pop. Yeah. He's done it over such a long.
So that was easy. The second best, though.
Oh, second best. Wow, that's a tough one. I'd probably go with Brad Stevens right now.
Really?
Yeah, I think he's done, you know, phenomenal job.
Why can't more people make that transition from college to the pros?
Great question. I've never been in a college. I'm really curious. I'm not surprised there's not more back and forth between the college and I know in the NFL it's like that, and college football there's more. I think the recruiting thing is such a different animal with the college stuff, and I know a lot of pro guys like, no way, I'm not going to college.
It's hard to beg a 17-year-old.
Yeah, they just don't want to do it.
Yeah, Sean Marks does it for you.
Yeah, exactly. I just feel that's a great point.
Well, great to see you. Thanks for dropping
by. Michael, thanks so much for having me on.
I'm a big fan.
I'm a big fan. I told you I listened to you on my drive home from work, and all down you too. And I just enjoy it. It's great. It's part of being a New Yorker, like being so ingrained. You know, the sports radio is such a huge part of our sports culture.
Let's get thanks, 10 Kenny. More. From yeah. 8 more to 10 more.
Okay. I like you got a lofty goal there, but I appreciate it.
And, of course, you can see the Nets all the time on YES. They are part of the YES family. And, again, thank you for coming by, Kenny.